Today is the very first Sunday of Lent, and the epistle reading is taken from St. Paul's epistle to the Corinthians. Brethren, we entreat you not to offer God's grace an ineffectual welcome. I have answered thy prayer, he saith, in a time of pardon. I have brought thee help in a day of salvation. And this is the time of pardon. This is the day of salvation. We are careful not to give offense to anyone, lest we should bring discredit upon our ministry. As God's ministers, we must do everything to make ourselves acceptable. We must show great patience in times of affliction, in times of need, of difficulty, under the lash, in prison, in the midst of tumult, when we are tired, sleepless, and fasting. We must be pure-minded, enlightened, forgiving, and gracious to others. We must rely on the Holy Spirit, on unaffected love, on the truth of our message, on the power of God. We must be armed, the right arm and the left hand, with innocence. Now honored, now slighted, now traduced, now flattered. They call us deceivers, and yet we tell the truth. They say we are unknown, and yet we are fully acknowledged. They say we are dying, and yet behold, we live. They say we are punished, yes, but not doomed to die. Sad men that rejoice continually, beggars that bring riches to many, disinherited, and yet the world is ours. Please stand for the Holy Gospel. The Gospel reading is taken from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. At that time, Jesus was led by the Spirit away into the wilderness, there to be tempted by the devil. 40 days and 40 nights he spent fasting, and at the end of that time was hungry. Then the tempter approached and saith to him, If thou indeed be the Son of God, bid these stones turn into loaves of bread. In reply, Jesus said, It is written, Man cannot live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth from the mouth of God. Next, the devil took him into the holy city, and there set him down on the pinnacle of the temple, and saith to him, If thou art the Son of God, cast thyself down to earth. For it is written, He has given charge to his angels concerning thee, and they will hold thee up, lest thou should dash thy foot upon a stone. And Jesus saith to him, It is further written, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Once more the devil took him to the top of an exceedingly high mountain, from which he showed him all the kingdoms of the world and all the glory of them. And he said, I will give thee all these if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Then Jesus saith to him, Begone, Satan, it is written, The Lord thy God shalt thou worship, and him only shalt thou serve. Then the devil left him alone, and thereupon angels came and ministered unto him. This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus. The announcements. The Mass this evening is offered for the intention of all the people in our parish. On every Friday of Lent, soup suppers will be at 6 p.m. in the auditorium and Stations of the Cross at 7:15 in the church. Father Kevin Kennedy will be speaking on the last three Fridays of Lent on Our Blessed Mother. Next Saturday, there will be three excellent conferences, a good way to enrich your Lent. First is the annual Latin Mass Conference in Monterey with Bishop Athanasius Snyder. Second is the Spiritual Warfare Conference in Menlo Park with Father Robert Spitzer. And third is the Stewardship Conference in Belmont. Last week, Father Ilo made the annual archdiocesan appeal. Our goal this year is 77,000. If you are registered in the parish, you should have received a letter and a pledge form. If you are not registered or have not yet made your gift, please consider supporting the parish and archbishop by taking a pledge form available at the door. Please keep your handbags and other valuables close to your person while in the church. Last week, one of our members had her bag stolen by a professional thief. Details on all these events are found in the weekly bulletins, which are available at the doors of the church. This evening, I want to contrast two radically incompatible interpretations of the event of the temptation of Christ in the desert. The first interpretation I want to talk about reflects the influence of what is generally called process philosophy. Now, the exponents of process philosophy maintain that reality is sheer process, a constant stream of, a constant stream and flow of movement which never reaches a terminus ad quem. This is a process from which no stable, completely definable thing ever emerges. In this view, being is simply identified with becoming, and from this constant becoming, no being emerges. Now, when this philosophy is applied with some modifications to the theology of the incarnation itself is described as an evolutionary process. An evolutionary process in which Christ gradually and progressively evolves towards divinity. And this evolutionary process towards divinity develops according to certain stages. Christ's birth, his temptation in the desert, his baptism, and of course it is at his baptism that Christ comes to the realization of his messianic mission. And the final stage in this process is the resurrection event. At this moment, Christ has evolved into Godhead, into divinity. But for many theologians, within the Godhead itself, the process of evolution continues unceasingly and forever. Now, within the context of this philosophical, theological viewpoint, at the time of our Lord's temptation in the desert, which was an early stage in his movement towards divinity, Christ could really experience internal temptations exactly as we do. In other words, at this early stage in his evolution, Christ could be really attracted to non-moral, but nonetheless appealing and attractive objects. Christ never actually sinned, if that is admitted. But at this point, the point of the temptation in the desert, Christ was by no means immune to the tendency, the inclination, and the proclivity towards sin. Now, this position, this theory, even though it is entirely inconsistent with our own tradition, has seeped into the area of popular theology. It can even be found expressed in Catholic newspapers and in Sunday bulletins. For example, in the San Francisco Catholic for February the 8th, 2008, we read, "Not even Christ was immune from the internal experience of temptation. Jesus' incarnation began at his birth, it broadened at his baptism, intensifies as he subjects himself to temptation. Participating in our fragility and vulnerability, Jesus feels the power powers of darkness arrayed against him in their attempt to dissuade him from the mission his Father has given him. Not only in temptations, but by embracing our existential angst through uncertainty, misunderstanding, confusion, and opposition. In these ways, Jesus identifies with us. That's from the San Francisco Catholic, February 8th, 2008. And from a Sunday bulletin, and this of course is a publication that is sent to all different parishes and is disseminated in many parishes, we read the description of the temptation in the desert evokes a great struggle taking place within Jesus, the struggle for the direction of his life. Jesus confronts the beast within himself, all those evil instincts which, if unchecked, can dehumanize the human person. At the end of this period of temptation, and on the eve of his baptism, Jesus is finally able to set the course of his life. Well, this particular one sounds like he's using a kind of Jungian perspective here, the hero's journey, the integration of shadow and persona. Now, this approach to the incarnation is not official church teaching, obviously, and it has no claim to magisterial support, but it has become quite popular, and as I said, one finds it in popular Catholic literature. Now, by way of contrast, there is the traditional interpretation of the temptation event. And by traditional, I mean the unanimous teaching of the fathers of the church, the teaching of the great scholastics of the high Middle Ages, the teaching of the great doctors of the church, and the teaching of the magisterium. Pius XII is the last pope, actually, who have declared that Jesus had the beatific vision from the beginning of his conception in the womb of Our Lady. In a word, the traditional teaching is the constant and universal belief of the church. Now, from the traditional Catholic viewpoint, the incarnation was complete from the very beginning. From the instant the eternal Word himself assumed a created human nature in the womb of the most blessed and ever Virgin Mary, he is true God and true man, not evolving towards anything. He is already ad incipiendum, true God and true man. And the hypostatic union, the union of two distinct natures in the one divine person of the second person of the Blessed Trinity, this union had as a necessary effect the glorification of Christ's human soul. And this meant that Christ's human intellect and his human will were created in the state of actual operational perfection. In fact, the theme Homo Perfectus is the operational theme in Catholic theology, at least up to Vatican II, when it comes to discussing the incarnation and Jesus Christ. Now, his human intellect, since it was created in maximal perfection, enjoyed the beatific vision as a direct consequence of the union. And since his human intellect enjoyed the beatific vision, his human will was created as absolutely and necessarily and irreversibly confirmed in perfect righteousness. So because of the beatific vision, Christ in his human intellect could never be confused about the will of the Father or about where the bonum honestum actually lay in any situation. And because of his perfect rectitude and will, he could never be attracted to any object not entirely compatible with the authentic moral good. In other words, no inclination to sin could ever arise in Christ. So what are the consequences of this traditional position for Christ's encounter with the devil in the temptation account? The fathers of the church describe Christ as the new Adam, an entirely new creation. He is the Word through whom the world was made. And this Word has become flesh and dwelt amongst us. This new Adam, an entirely new creation, enters the desert, Satan's lair, to undo what the old Adam had done by sin. And so St. John Chrysostom writes, Christ as challenger went forth into the desert and provoked the devil to draw near. Christ provokes the devil to exert his power fully. And even as Satan exerts his power to the utmost, Christ divests him of it and deposes him. Begone, Satan, for it is written, the Lord thy God shalt thou adore, and him only shalt thou serve. And St. Jerome wrote, Christ as the new Adam went out into the desert led by the desire for combat with Satan. The fathers also point out that the second temptation event, the temptation of Christ in the desert, totally reverses the first temptation event, the temptation of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. And so St. Thomas writes, the same order the devil employed to tempt the first man, Adam, this order also he observed in tempting Christ. By these means Satan laid low the first man. By these same means was he defeated by the second man, who is Jesus Christ. And in his explanation of the precise meaning of saying that Jesus was tempted by the devil, St. Gregory the Great writes, we should keep in mind that temptation is accomplished in three stages, by outward suggestion, by inward delight, and inward consent. Now, God, who became incarnate in the womb of the Virgin Mary, entered into this world without sin, no original sin, and had within him, therefore, no source of this conflict which plagues us. Jesus, therefore, could be tempted only by outward suggestion from the devil, but the delight of sin could take no hold on his mind. And so all this diabolical temptation was entirely from without and not at all from within. And St. Thomas, following the mind of St. Gregory the Great, writes, Christ was tempted by mere outward suggestion from the enemy. But this outward suggestion did not beget or occasion in Christ the confusion and the inclination to disorder and to sin that can arise in us because of concupiscence and irascibility. So we have St. Gregory the Great representing the patristic tradition, the fathers of the church, and St. Thomas Aquinas representing the great scholastic tradition of the High Middle Ages and representing the doctors of the church. And these two, separated by many centuries, are in perfect concurrence. Finally, the temptation event is not to be regarded as simply an isolated event. The pattern of Christ's triumph over the devil here in the desert will be repeated in Christ's miracles, in his power over demons, his power over the natural elements, his power over sickness and death. And the same pattern of victory and triumph over Satan is repeated again in the resurrection and in the ascension. And the full expression and manifestation of Christ's triumph over Satan will be manifested entirely, fully, completely, unmistakably, at the second coming in Ultima Dei. So In a way, you can say that the event of the temptation of Christ is a kind of picture of the whole ministry of Jesus in miniature. Because remember, the great theologian Louis Boyer, writing before the Second Vatican Council, wrote that the purpose of Jesus, the reason why he came into the world, was to drive the devil out of the world. And in the temptation event, we see the beginnings of the conflict between Christ and Satan, which inevitably and invariably ends in the triumph of Christ and the deposition of the devil.